We touched bottom and we touched the sky. Hand in hand through the hardest time. You have given me every part all the way through. Darling, rain or shine, you will always be the story of my life. From moment one till the day I die, the story of my life is you.
Hello and welcome, everybody. I'm Sebastian Romero from Arduino, and today I want to talk about predictive maintenance with Arduino-based LoRa solutions. So this session is meant to be a bit of an inspiration for you, what you could do with predictive maintenance, but not so much going into all the technical details, but I'll give some examples. So I'm going to provide some inspiration, but also provide some starting points on how to do this. So let's see. Who here has heard of Arduino before? All right. So the majority or the ones who don't want to raise their hands. That's also fine. So it's an open electronics platform based on easy-to-use hardware and software. And what we do is that we provide an abstraction layer on top of the hardware, which means that if you write an application, then you can deploy it to different targets. Can even be a non-original Arduino. And on many of our products, we have integrated sensors, which makes it very easy for you to talk to these sensors, so you don't have to worry about how to do that. And for these sensors, we usually provide sensible defaults, which means that you don't have to worry much about the configuration, but you can just start to play with them. And if that's not enough, you can always extend the capabilities of your Arduino board by getting a shield or a carrier board to add additional sensors or to control actuators. There's thousands of libraries to support almost any kind of sensor or actuator out there, a lot of them provided by the community, and of which we have more than 30 million people worldwide, so a huge community to provide you with inspiration and support. So for those ones who haven't heard about Arduino, you've probably seen these two things here. So Arduino has been kind of the foundation of the whole 3D printing technology, and also for drones, and still is today. But I'm here today for Arduino Pro, which is kind of a new-ish pillar at Arduino. And it's meant as a continuation of the learning path that you maybe had at university or at school. That allows you to continue with that in an industrial environment. But even if you come from a maker side, it's meant to transfer the creativity and the productivity that a lot of these makers have enjoyed using Arduino and apply that to the business world. And the Pro products really are meant to comply with industry standards, such as form factor or temperature or vibration resistance, and are meant to be used in final solutions. So you can take whatever you prototyped and use the same technology to bring that to the market. So let's have a quick look at the hardware that Arduino provides for LoRa-based applications. So the classic one that you may have seen is the MakerBand 1310, which is kind of a good board to start with. It has a LoRa module, and it has a battery connector, so you can implement portable solutions. But if you need a little bit more oomph, then you can opt for Arduino Pro products. So this is a combination between a board and a shield. So it's the Portenta H7, which is a very powerful dual-core microcontroller. And it gives you Wi-Fi and BLE connectivity. But if you add the vision shield to it, that adds LoRa capabilities, but also adds a camera and microphones if you want to do machine vision or sound-based applications, so you can do it. Then, very recently, we launched the thing on the left that you see. It's called the Portenta X8. It's our, I will say, first proper Linux-based board. So it has a fully featured IMX8 processor, but not just that, it has also a dual-core microcontroller on it for real-time applications. And if you want to add connectivity to it, you can use the Portenta Max carrier, which comes with all sorts of connectivity features like NB-IoT, Cat-M1. It comes also with LoRa, obviously, and supports a variety of different serial protocols. And you can even do sound things with the headphone and the microphone port if you wish to do so. And it's especially interesting if you think about all the Linux applications that you can run with that. Then there's these two boards from the Nikla family, and they don't have LoRa capabilities themselves, so they're rather meant to be used as sensor nodes. So if you want to do something with sensors, you can use those boards. The Nikla Sense, for example, it can measure gas, it can measure pressure, it has an IMU and magnetometer. But if you want to do, on the other hand, more machine vision applications, then you can go for the Nikla Vision, which has a camera and a microphone. And also very recently, we released these two products in partnership with RAG Wireless. So it's two LoRa gateways, one for indoor, one for outdoor. So that kind of completes the whole pipeline from sensor nodes over boards that can connect as LoRa end devices to the LoRa gateways. So now we can have everything from Arduino if you want to. But we're here for predictive maintenance, so let's talk a bit about that. I want to discuss a few key points that I think are important. And the first one is that there's a difference between maintenance and repair. So if you need to repair something, it's kind of a bit too late already, so something already broke. And if that's a production environment and you have time-sensitive processes, that's usually, you know, the urgent things when, you know, when things are on fire and somebody needs to fix things very urgently. So you kind of want to avoid that. But to do so, you do maintenance, right? And maintenance are preventive measurements that should allow a machine to run as long as possible. And in that sense, it's failure prevention. Now, with maintenance, there's two types that I want to distinguish. And one of them is scheduled maintenance, which means that you schedule maintenance like every couple of months, for example. Somebody would show up, they would inspect the machine or an installation. They figure out if something needs to be replaced. If everything goes well, then they don't need to do anything. But it's effort. Predictive maintenance, on the other hand, is being more smart about that and make sort of the planning for maintenance informed by actual data. So predictive maintenance is, in a sense, smart maintenance. And it describes the techniques that you can use to analyze the condition of a hardware to sort of determine and predict if it's going well or if maintenance needs to be performed, ideally before something bad happens or if or before an inconvenient moment comes when you would need to do this maintenance. So I think it's fair to say that predictive maintenance is more efficient than scheduled maintenance. And I want to show just a few benefits from doing that. So you can save costs on not having to repair broken equipment in the first place. But also, ideally, you have a very short outage of machinery or no outage at all, if you do it the right way. And you can make use, a more efficient use of your maintenance staff because you have a better idea of when these people need to show up. And the same applies for spare parts. So if you know, if you're informed about when things might break, you don't have to have like thousands of pieces of replacement parts on stock. And usually, these kind of predictive maintenance solutions are technology agnostic, which means that you don't have to dive into the technical details of a certain type of machinery, but you usually attach them on top of that. And in that case, if you don't have to modify the hardware, you're not voiding the warranty, which is another great thing. You can do smart predictions by leveraging machine learning on microcontrollers. And maybe you have heard some of that from our partners, Edge Impulse. It's a way of augmenting the intelligence of billions of devices in our everyday appliances. And one reason is that it's very low cost. So you can get microcontrollers very cheap and embed them in everyday products. They can run on low power. So if you have something that runs on a battery, it's usually not a problem to add a microcontroller with machine learning to it. Another great thing is that the machine learning runs locally on that microcontroller, which means that there's no connectivity required. And that again means that your data stays on the device, which ensures data privacy. So, but why would you use machine learning in the first place? Can't you just, you know, inspect the sensor data and then come up with some smart rules? And the answer is yes, you can do it, but it's difficult. So you can sit down and analyze some patterns of data and then try to figure out some smart rules, like what should happen if a certain sensor pattern shows up. But these patterns can vary, and humans are not really good at that, not really good at like figuring these things out, but machine learning really is. So it's not a problem at all for machine learning to have such variations in the data. If you want to do machine learning on microcontrollers, we usually recommend our tool from our partners, Edge Impulse, which makes that very easy. So the process there is that it helps you to gather the data from the microcontrollers in the first place, but you can also leverage existing data sets. And then it helps you to process that data, so filter out what's not needed or tune the signals to a certain use case. And then it allows you to extract the features, and the features are basically the unique characteristics of a piece of data. So something that constitutes a certain so-called class in machine learning. And then it allows you to train a machine learning model that you can then easily deploy to your microcontroller and run it. Another thing which I find important for predictive maintenance is remote monitoring and remote control, because you somehow need to access the data that's being collected on a device or a machinery. And Arduino's offering for that is called IoT Cloud. And you see on the right-hand side, there's an example of a dashboard. So it basically allows you to have data containers and allows you to have a nice UI to visualize these things. So in this example, you could maybe inspect the hardware status of a device very easily. You can read sensor data. You can read the history of sensors over time. And you can even do things like sending messages to your maintenance staff, for example, or trigger actions. So if a device, for example, is about to break, you could turn it off remotely. So all of that is doable very easily. But it had like a bit of a drawback until now. So when you had to do this for many devices, so if you want to have sort of the same data collection on 100 devices, you would have to set this up 100 times. And we listened to you guys, so we implemented something called the Cloud CLI. So now this is no longer a tedious task. With the Cloud CLI, what you can do is that you create a template for what we call the things, so the data containers. And then on the command line, you can create as many as you wish with the same properties. Same applies for the dashboards. So if you need multiple dashboards to observe multiple devices, now you can do it very easily also with the Arduino Cloud CLI. Very cool tool. You should definitely check it out if you have been using Arduino IoT Cloud. Then to tie this back into sort of the context of LoRa and LoRaWAN, the question was always, how do you get the data from the devices to IoT Cloud if you want to use LoRaWAN? And it has been possible, but has been a bit tricky because you needed to configure everything correctly. And it was a bit error-prone. Now it's super easy to do because we partnered with the things industries to provide an actual integration. So now the boards can connect to IoT Cloud over a LoRaWAN backend. And on our stack, we have the usual 99.9% SLA. So you will have a great uptime. And if you configure a device in the Arduino IoT Cloud backend, as you see on the right-hand side, what happens behind the scenes is that it automatically configures the application on the thing stack. It configures the device on the thing stack. And you don't need to take care of any of that. And what's even better is that it takes care of the marshalling and unmarshalling of data. So if any of you ever had to somehow smartly package up data to transmit it as efficiently as possible over LoRaWAN, you know it's a bit, you know, it's not so easy to do. And luckily, if you use this solution, you don't need to do this. So you just have your variables in your application. They magically get packed up and is sent efficiently to the LoRaWAN backend. Now, as I said, in this session, I mainly want to provide you with a bit of inspiration. What can you do with predictive maintenance, and what would be a starting point for implementing them? So I was thinking of a few examples that I could show you and give a bit of, let's say, some code or some like sources on how to do that. First one is gas detection. So you could use, for example, the Nikla sense, which has a gas sensor from Bosch Sensor Tech, to detect anomalies in gases to prevent harm or damage. And the specific application that I thought of was you could, for example, detect wine going bad in a barrel as it's aging through maybe too fast fermentation or too fast oxidation. So the oxidation changes the gas compounds in the barrel, so that could be measured, or the fermentation produces CO2, which is also something that you can measure using these sensors. And I know you guys want to see some code, right? Like, we're here at the tech conference, so let's check out some code. It's very easy to read from these sensors. So as I promised in one of the first slides, what you need to do here in the setup function, you see that you basically configure the sensor, so you just tell it that it should start. You can add additional parameters if you want. You don't have to. And then in the loop, you just query what the sensor delivers, as easy as that. And then if you want, you can pass this on to the cloud or do something else with it. Not even machine learning required if it's a linear process, so to speak. And if you put that in a barrel, you may not want to have like a cable going through the barrel, so you can also query that data over BLE. So you could put that in a barrel, seal it, and leave it there. If you do that, you probably want to also add a battery, and you can do that as well. And then you would monitor this value over time to kind of ensure a normal aging process of the wine. So if any one of you is like a winemaker, maybe I'll see some cool solutions soon. Then another thing you can do is to use sound and machine learning in combination. So you can use machine learning to detect anomalies in sound. And one example that I thought of could be to detect the sound of broken glass at an assembly line in a factory. So in this image, you see a machine that has like a suction system to pull these glass doors. I think they're for washing machines, and then, you know, like lift them from one conveyor belt to the other and so on. So if they wear out or if the positioning is off, they may break them or unwillingly throw them onto the floor and they would break. But you could react very quickly if you could detect that sound. And this is very easy to do. So I tried to implement a demo, and it took me maybe half an hour to get this up and running. I don't have it here on stage, but if you want, you can swing by the booth later on and I can show you. I'll bring a glass that you can smash onto the floor so we can try it out. So first, you need obviously some data. So either you collect the data yourself, so you record the data, or you find existing data sets. So I did that for this demo that I did for myself. And I found the ESC50 data set, which is a collection of a couple of hundred files with environmental sound data. So from that one, I took the breaking glass files. And then I needed also some background noise. And the first thing that I found was this ambient noise from a hospital. Well, maybe you don't have to go to a hospital to test it, but this should work also in different contexts. So I took these two data sets, and then what I did is I just uploaded them to Edge Impulse Studio, and then you only need to classify them, meaning that you have to give them labels. So you have to tell which of these WAV files stands for what. So one is broken glass, the other one is background noise, just that. You need to think about window size when you process that kind of data, but also other signal data. And the window size basically defines how many milliseconds of data is being looked at once to do a classification. And if you think about this specific example, breaking glass is like a short sound, so probably like a fraction of a second if you smash something on the floor. It's a quick sound, so maybe a window size less than 1 second is good enough. So I tried it with the default of 1 second, and it worked perfectly fine. So all that's left to do then is you have to let the application train the model, and I did that. It wasn't very good, and that because when the default is set to use the optimized version, so it cuts off all the floating point numbers. So I changed that to the unoptimized one, and that was like way better. It's actually like surprisingly good, almost too good to be true. So we probably have some overfitting in there. Anyway, I did that, and then all that's left to do is you export it from the tool, and it exports a library and an Arduino sketch. So you don't need to do anything. You just upload it to the board, and then it spits out the confidence levels for each of these classes. So in this case, I just smashed one bottle, and it was 74% sure that it was a bottle. So it was worth a try. If you don't want to compile it yourself, then you can also download a ready-made firmware, upload that one to the board, and use Edge Impulse, run Impulse tool to do the inference like that. And by the way, running inference just means running the classification, running the machine learning model. Okay, then another thing is vibration and machine learning. So you could also think about this combination for predictive maintenance. So you use that to detect anomalies in vibration data patterns. And this specific example is about detecting a worn-out fan of a ventilation system. So the assumption would be that the fan starts to vibrate weirdly if it's about to break. So I also did a quick demo for that. And the process could look like this. So if you want to send it all the way from the board to our cloud solution where you have a dashboard, that's how it looks like. So you read from the sensor, and then on the board, the classification runs. And if it detects, there's a vibration, like there's something not good here, it sends that information over a cable to another board that has LoRa capabilities. In this case, it's the LoRa, the Maker WAN 1310. And that one sends it over LoRa, over the Things network, to our IoT cloud servers. To gather the IMU data, you have to query the accelerometer, and I did that. But usually, so the motion happens on three different axes in the 3D world, but I wanted to simplify that a little bit for this demo, and obviously you can do that easily by calculating just the magnitude of motion. So I didn't worry about the direction of motion, just how much does it actually vibrate. If you don't do that, you can do it. It's more precise, but then you also need to think about how to mount the sensor. So if you train it, let's say you put the board like this and you train the machine learning model like that, when you run the inference, it has to be the same orientation because otherwise the values of the axes are not correct. So you see on the right-hand side, there's sort of fluctuation is when the thing was vibrating. So you can actually detect that very easily. Again, some code. Woo! This is how you read from the IMU, again, quite easily. So I wanted to have 100 hertz sampling rates, and I wanted to calculate the magnitude of this motion. So again, you just in the setup function, you just start the sensor, and then in the loop, you can just query the sensor data at your interval, which I did with the millis function. And then I calculate the power by using the formula that we've seen in the previous slide. Very easy. And then it spits out just one number that you can feed into the machine learning. For that application, you can tune it a bit if you want to. So it spits out certain frequencies, right? So the vibration usually has one or multiple frequencies at which it vibrates. And for this application, I kind of figured not all of them are relevant. So if I want to have like a cleaner signal and more like polished data to process, I can do it by applying certain parameters. For example, here I chose to cut it off at 30 hertz because looking at the data, I kind of realized everything above 30 hertz does not constitute to that vibration pattern. So I just cut it off. So you can do these kind of optimizations to make it more robust. And then, the same story, you upload, you train the machine learning model, you upload the machine learning model to your board, it does the classification when it finds something, sends it over the other board to the cloud, and then you can inspect it if you want. So it could track, for example, the device status based on that classification, and you can also track the history. So in this case, it could be that this fan is failing, but it vibrates only every couple of hours. And this would allow you to see that. So maybe you see every 5 hours it starts to vibrate. Maybe there's a cause for that. So it allows you to inspect these kind of things. And also, if you want to, you could intervene. For example, you could add a switch to turn off the ventilation if you think it's gonna, if it's about to break and, you know, ruin the whole machinery. And that's the last example I want to talk about. It's the combination of machine vision and machine learning. And it's basically to use machine vision plus machine learning to detect visual anomalies or detect the presence or absence of objects in a camera image. And the example I was thinking of, and this is also going to be the topic for tomorrow's workshop at 1, so if you guys want to join and learn how to implement that, it's about predicting insect infestation by counting the amount of different types of insects. So there's these insect traps already existing right now, but usually it's a manual process. So somebody, it has an adhesive paper, and then somebody goes there maybe once a day or once a week, whatever you decide, and then goes and picks up these papers. They have to count the bugs and so on. So the idea is, like, why don't you make that smart and IoT capable? So first of all, you don't need to go there, and then you have the data more quickly available. And for that, I was using a different technology provided by Edgepulse. It's called FOMO, so it means faster objects, more objects. It's a new technology that allows you to not only classify a whole image, but it allows you to actually detect the objects inside an image and lets you count them, which is exactly what we wanted to do for this insect trap. So in their tool, you can snap a couple of pictures, and then you draw some rectangles around these, in this case, different insects, and then it learns how these insects look like, and then lets you run the object detection and spits out basically how many of those insects it has seen in the image and where are they located. This one may not look familiar to you. It's not the Arduino IDE. It's called the OpenNV IDE, which is made by our partner OpenNV. So it's basically an IDE that's geared towards machine vision applications, and it supports all our new Arduino boards from the Pro line, and it allows you to write your scripts in MicroPython. So it's very easy to do, but if you want to learn more about that and get some more details on how to implement it from A to Z, then come tomorrow to the workshop. I'll show you how to do it. That's all I wanted to talk about. I think we may have a few more minutes for questions. So if yes, then please ask them. Otherwise, thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed the session.